calls this morning, and also the visiting friends, persons who come, who are not a member of our church, who are, you know, just consistently come and visit us now and then. We appreciate your presence, we appreciate you being with us, and we don't take your presence here for granted. We just want to thank everybody, children, who are there, everybody. Thank you for being here this morning. Greetings to everyone.
Big up yourself, sister.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah.
We praise the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Hallelujah. The Lord has given me a task, a mandate for this morning. He has instructed me to remind the brethren, to remind us of who he is, to remind us of why he did what he did, to remind us of what his expectations are of us. And so that is what my focus is on this morning, to remind us about who Jesus is.
Amen.
I don't know how many of us, well, I guess most of us would have recognized how the Lord has been speaking to us as a church over the last 8 or so weeks. And he has been making it known to us who he is from the Gospel of John, where we're looking at the seven I Am's. But then it culminated last week when he declared that he was I Am, he was the
God,
he was the light of the world, he was a good shepherd, he was the bread of life, he was the way, he was the vine, and all the seven I Am's. But in the midst of him declaring who he is, he showed up when they needed him to be that. And he's saying to us as a church, whatever we need,
God is.
He is. God he is. Is. We do not lack anything because
anything
Jesus is the mighty God. He is the I Am that I Am. We do not lack anything. Even in our individual lives, we lack nothing because God is. And as I continue to look at who God is, the Lord has instructed me to remind us about who Jesus Christ is. Because everything is about him and for him and of him. We are here because of him. And sometimes we miss what this thing is all about. Get so caught up in the routine of coming to church. We get so caught up in the routine of being, you know, a church or a believer, but sometimes just need to be reminded of what he has done that has brought us to where we are this morning. Where you're going, you see me looking at me. You know, it's Jesus did something.
Amen.
He did something. I want us to turn our Bibles to Genesis chapter 3 and verse 16. And then we'll also be looking at Ephesians 1, verses 4 and 5. Genesis 3, verse 15.
Stand for the reading. Stand for the reading.
Yes, and stand for the reading of the word of God. I'm going to read while you follow. Reading from the NIV, Genesis 3, verse 18. And it says, God speaking, and he said, and I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. And let me read that again. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel. Ephesians 1, 4-5, it says, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation now, even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in his eyes. God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So Father, this morning we just want to thank you for your words. We want to thank you, Lord God, that you are the word. Mighty God, we have read your word. Lord God, we recognize that it is Jesus that we are about and speak about, and you are represented in your word. Your word declares, Lord God, that you, oh God, you came their abode, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The flesh that we talk about there is Jesus. You are the Word. And Lord, you are the living Word. And so, Father, as we have engaged your Word this morning, we pray that you will speak to the hearts of us, your people. Father, we pray that exactly what it is that you want us to get this morning, that we will get it in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray that you, oh God, will speak in such a way, Lord, that you transition us from where we are to where you desire for us to be as a people, as a church, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, you may sit here. The Word of God tells us that God was God's plan to redeem mankind. From day one, it was His plan. It was God's plan from inception to find a way to reconcile man back to Himself. And it didn't start when Mary conceived. This plan didn't come into gear when Mary gave birth or was conceived with a child. As we saw in Genesis 3 verse 15, we saw a prophetic word being spoken here, where it was said that God would put enmity between the man and the serpent. And what would have happened? The offspring of the woman would crush the head of the serpent, but the serpent would have only been able to bruise the heel. And that was talking about Jesus. Jesus, as we know, fast forward, crushed the head of the serpent. But we know that his heel was only bruised a little because he was crucified. Now, this was God's plan from the beginning of time, that Jesus would have come and to redeem mankind, would have taken authority from the enemy to bring back his people to himself. Jesus loved us so much. God loved us so much. He orchestrated a plan from day one to bring us back to himself. The fall happened, Adam and Eve sinned, but that brought separation at that point. But it didn't end there, because immediately God declared what would have happened. And what would have happened if Jesus would have come? And though it tarried, mighty God, though it took years before Jesus graced us with his presence, it happened.
Amen.
And we're living in that reality now. We're living in that reality now because Jesus is still alive. So here we are. in Ephesians 1 and verse 5, it says, God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us into himself through Jesus Christ. Who would God have used to bring us back to himself? Through Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ mended the bridge that was broken between us and God. When Adam and Eve sinned, it brought a wedge between us and God. The God that we serve is such a holy God. That even though he loved us so much, he could not entertain us in his presence. So he had to find a way to get close to us. How did he do that? Through Jesus.
Yes.
Jesus did it. Jesus bridged the gap.
Yes.
Jesus brought on the wall of partition between us and God. That we can enter into the presence of the living God once more.
Yeah, man.
It's about him.
Yes.
It's about him. God loves us so much that he does not want us to suffer. Because the wages of sin is death. And the issue that God has with mankind from day one is sin. The remedy for sin is Jesus hung on the cross. Where he took upon himself sin, became sin for us. What Jesus did, he broke every chain of sin from off of us, making it possible for us to live above sin. We can't live in and of ourselves. It takes Jesus. So here we are. Who is Jesus? The Bible tells us in Hebrews 2 verse 14, because God's children are human beings, made of flesh and blood, the Son also became flesh and blood. For only as a human being could he die. And only by dying could he break the power of the devil who had a power of death. It is not God's will that any perish, but that all would come to repentance. And so the God, Jesus, who was in the Father from day one, the Bible tells us, he came and he took on the robe of flesh and dwelt among men. He lived as a man, but he was also divine. He was God. Because he was birthed by the Holy Spirit himself. But his mother was a woman, a human being. And so the God Jesus that we talk about was both divine and human. And we know that he was human because we saw so many traits of his human nature throughout scriptures. He wept when his friend died.
Yes.
He was an agony looking at the cross, and he was in such anxiety about what was to happen to him. He knew his death was imminent. And Jesus had to become a human being. And every time I think about it, he was in heaven with the Father, so protected from the stench of earth. So just to leave that place of bliss to come and take on flesh that himself was anguish for him. Sometimes we are in a space where the atmosphere is so clean and crisp. Sometimes when you go to the country, the air that we breathe is so fresh and refreshing. But when you go to Riverton Dump, there's a different smell, a different atmosphere. And I like that to just to give an idea as to what Jesus had to undergo just to bridge the gap, to bring us back to the Father. Mighty God. And so, the one that we serve, he is the eternal God. The Bible tells us, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. was being spoken into being. He was there when stars were called into existence. He was there when all living creatures were made. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The Christ that we speak about, Jesus, he came and dwelt among us. He is the omnipotent one, the powerful one. He's the omnipresent one. He is everywhere. He's omniscient. He's all-knowing. He's eternal. He exists in the past and in the present. Mighty God. We're talking about Jesus Christ. The immutable. He doesn't change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Who is Jesus?
Amen.
Who is Jesus? Hey. No one has ever seen God but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, according to John 1 and verse 18. Jesus Christ was fully God, but he was also fully human being. And so he asked his disciples, who do men say that I am? He knew who he was, but he wanted to get from them. Who do you say I am? And I believe Jesus is asking the same question to all of us. Because sometimes our perspective of Jesus is based on what other people say about him. But Jesus is a very personal person.
Amen, amen.
He's not a figment of our imagination. Just as though he came in the flesh, he is still with us through his spirit. Before he left, he promised his disciples. He had to go, but someone greater is going to come in his place. And that person is the person of the Holy Spirit. And he came on the day of Pentecost and he's still here. Why? Why all of this? God loved us, yes. God is, Jesus is God. God sent him to represent himself in the earth, the mirror, what he wants us, his children, to be. But why? Why? Why was all of this necessary? Mighty God. For God so loved us, the Lord tells us, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish. Whoever believes in him will not perish. It is a battle for the soul of man. Sometimes we're thinking about eternity. Sometimes the decisions that we make, it makes eternity seem like it doesn't exist. Sometimes we're even though we don't think we're going to die at some point. But Jesus saw that. He made provision from the beginning to the end. So that when that time comes, when you become absent from the body, those who are in Christ will present with him. That is promised, the first to escape hell. And we don't talk about hell that often not exist and it is real. And that is the reason, one of the reasons why Jesus had to come. So that we don't go to where God did not design for us to go. Because hell was never designed for us.
Amen. Amen.
It was designed for the devil and his demons. But Jesus made a way for us to escape.
Escape, yes.
For us to escape hell, death. Mighty God.
For your life,
God so loved us that he demonstrated his love to us.
Mm-hmm.
In that while you are sinners,
Christ died.
He died. Some of us are still in our sinful state. But Jesus' death is saying to us today, is death, burial, and resurrection, because he knows.
There's a remedy.
He's saying that he is a remedy for sin. Mm-hmm. And though he is here, though he has accomplished this for us, it still requires a decision from all of us.
Oh, yes.
And some of us have made that decision. Some of us have said yes to Jesus. But there's still more that he requires of us. There's still more that he expects of us. The Bible says, when we were not thinking about him, he thought about us. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some may call slackness, but is not suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all come to repentance. It's a battle for the soul. It's a battle for the soul. tells us in Galatians 4, which I read earlier. Galatians 4, 45, but when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship. He wants us to be his child, his children. He wants us to be considered his daughter, his son. Sonship means, he's talking about position. We're not outcasts anymore.
Holy Ghost.
The Bible says we're seated with Christ in heavenly places. Far above all principalities and powers and rulers of darkness. He has elevated our position. Now we have not recognized that our position has shifted.
Amen.
Keep ignoring it!
get over.
Yeah! cost
you. It requires sacrifice. You have to make a decision to pursue yourself. Then it's stand your feet. Pursue it all your heart. Loving with your whole heart. Serve the Lord. Three times he said it. Some things happen in our lives that cause us to run.
You shut up. You shut up. You. 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 You.
There is a separation in the sight of the
How can you be made to them and perish?
Man, be all done.
Some of us have some wounds here. The hand has side. Where we have the wounds, it's supposed to be anymore. Hey, but we're not admitting because of one. The devil has run away from the red lines. Every issue, every problem, God can fix because God is.
God is.
If you don't fix the car, you know why it's going to fix.
God is.
That's his promise to us. That's his promise to us. God is. God is awesome. God is. It's all about him, Pastor.
All about
it's not
about
all about
him. All about
it's about him.
All about him. All for him.
All we need is him, Pastor.
Amen.
It's about him.
All about him. It's about him. My God.
Give the Lord worship. Give the Lord worship. Give the Lord worship. All about him.